Well, our speaker is Francesca Vidotto from Radboud University in the Netherlands, and she's talking on Quanta of Spacetime in a non-singular universe.
Thank you for the introduction. So, and thank you, Daniele, because he made my life much easier with his talk this morning. So, in a sense, my talk will be a continuation of what we heard before. And Roman said repetita iuvant, so it's good to hear the same things but from a different perspective. So I hope this will help you to make up your mind about does it mean to have some quanta space-time to start with and then try to recover some way to do cosmology with that. So this would be the aim of my talk. But first, I needed to do some preliminaries because there is a lot of confusion when we talk about cosmology. So people have different things in mind, especially people that are not just doing the hard, dirty work. So there are different conceptions in cosmology for what it means to do cosmology. But actually, I think that it's good to refer with what is the actual practical work of cosmologists today, and this is what are represented by the power spectrum that you see there. So this is what cosmologists, real human cosmologists, are measuring today. So what is this? It is about measuring the large scale degrees of freedom of the universe. So you do an expansion in modes, and doing cosmology means that you are considering just the largest of those modes. So when largest, disregarding the short mode, what does it mean? Short here is equivalent to 2 million of light years. So we are not really dealing with Planckian modes. We are really dealing with something very, very large, even considering the higher numbers in our expansion. So the confusion comes attributing to the same word two meanings. So instead of thinking of cosmology as the theory of those largest modes, people have in mind that cosmology should be the theory of everything. And this is not what we are gonna talk about today. So the theory of everything is something else. We are not dealing with all the degrees of freedom of the universe, and in particular, we, the observer, we meaning we, humans, conscious beings, but also we, our telescopes, we, planet, we are not part of the degrees of freedom that we are describing. So in this sense, the observer is not part of the system. We are not part of the cosmology that we are going to describe. So the problem of the observer in cosmology in this sense is well defined. So usually another misconception is that usually when you think about doing the quantum mechanics of the system, you think that the system should be very, very small. And of course, the universe is not small at all. But there is a sense in which the universe, this big object, can be described in a certain regime by quantum equations. And this will be true for the early stages, the primordial era in our universe, even though something that I will stress later again is that even if we have such a description, we enter in this quantum regime doesn't mean that the universe becomes something of the Planck length. In fact, it can be something that is macroscopic, many order of magnitudes larger than the Planck length, and still being an object that should be described by equations that are quantum equations. So the plan of the talk, okay, so I have already done the first part, defining what I mean by cosmology. Then I was asked to talk about emergence, so I will start by saying a few words about this. And then I will try to tell you a bit about the research that has been ongoing in order to define quantum cosmology. And in particular, I will try to tell you more about possible strategies, exactly about how to go from this a quantum theory of gravity, a theory that describes quanta of space-time, how to do cosmology with them. So this will be the main part of my talks, and then I will conclude with some remarks about the fact that in a quantum theory of gravity, we have indications, we have very strong indications that there should be no curvature singularity there. And I will present this in a way that probably you haven't seen before. Okay, so first, a few words about emergence. And okay, the theory, the perspective I come from is the one of loop quantum gravity. In loop quantum gravity, we have a theory that tried to describe the dynamics of quanta of space-time. So the first thing to notice is that, of course, so these quanta are, so there is no space-time anymore, there is not a manifold there, but of course these quanta, they still preserve some properties from the classical space-time. In particular, these quanta in their self, they know about Lorentz invariance, they know about the local Lorentz invariance there. And so this is the first thing. So the first characteristic that we keep from the space-time as we know it from general relativity is this local Lorentz invariance. And the second thing is that we want to have a notion of adjacency. So even in the absence of a metric, we still have a way to tell who is next to who in this theory, and we do it using graphs. So the graphs is an abstract object that allows me to tell which quanta of space-time is in interaction with the other. So being in interaction, so here you see how the notion of locality informed all the theory here. So locality means being in interaction. So my graph tells me which quanta are in interaction with the other. And this is a way to tell the theory about localization in a way that is fully invariant by diffeomorphism. So because this graph can be, I mean, it's an abstract graph. It's not a graph that lives into some, embedded in some space-time. This graph represents the relation that makes up space-time itself. So in this sense, it's something that you can, you can deform, but it keeps these relations of adjacency in a fully diff-invariant manner. Okay, so more about mergers. And to do this, let me use an analogy, because we don't start from scratch. We always start by using the theories that we know better about. And so what is the theory? For instance, the theory that we know about is electromagnetism. So in electromagnetism, you start with some electromagnetic field, and your quantum theory will be defined with some states. In particular, this could be the states in the Fock space. So introducing a Fock space allow me to talk about particles, discrete entities of the electromagnetic field. Then I have observables that tells me the semantic of the theory, what are the interactions, the relevant interactions that I am considering. And then the dynamics that in the covariant theory will be given by some transition amplitude. So given these three ingredients, I give you the quantum theory. So going from the classical to the quantum theory, I start with my electromagnetic field, and I end up with a theory that is made of quanta of the electromagnetic field, namely a theory of photons. And then, if I wanted to go in the opposite direction, so I wanted to suppose I start with a sea of photons, and I wanted to recover classical electrodynamics. So what I wanted to recover the classical Maxwell equation. So I started from a theory that is discrete, it's made of quanta, it's fuzzy, it's probabilistic in the sense of those transition amplitudes, and then I take the classical limit, and in the classical limit, I get rid of the discreteness, I get rid of the fuzziness, and I get back to a classical field that has a continuous structure. So in gravity, we want to do the same. So in gravity, you start by a smooth manifold that represents your spacetime. And then, again, what we do in quantum gravity is to give an algorithm. We give you the states, the observables, the dynamics, for instance, in terms of a transition amplitude. And we end up with this theory for the quanta of spacetime. So what about emergence? So emergence, for me, is this classical limit. The limit in which I take h bar that goes to zero and I recover the Einstein equation. So I start from a discrete a theory that is discrete, is made of quanta of spacetime that are characterized by this the Planck basically. The theory has a fuzziness. The fuzziness simply comes from the fact that I have observables, I have quantum operators, and these quantum operators do not commute one another. So this is the usual fuzziness that appears when you go into quantum mechanics. And it's probabilistic, again, so I will describe the dynamics of this quantum space-time with some transition amplitude. And then, of course, I wanted to recover the classical theory, where the classical theory is encoded in my fundamental variables. That in my case will be the tetrads, that are those that embody the degrees of freedom of the gravitational field. So, and the tetrads are totally equivalent to a metric formulation. So more comments, briefly. So this is what I was saying before, that for me, the emergence of the classical spacetime is something that I recover taking the limit of h bar that goes to zero in the theory. And in the theory, I'm talking about loop quantum gravity. We have transition amplitudes. There are theorems that tells you that in the classical limit, this theory recovers general relativity. There is no difference the emergence that I have in mind is the same kind of emergence that you can think for photons giving you the electromagnetic field. Of course, in the deep quantum regime, your space-time is not the usual space-time in the sense that you don't have a manifold anymore. You have this quanta, but this quanta, they preserve some characteristics. So in a sense, if you ask the question, is there space-time at the fundamental level? So yes or no, it depends what you mean by space-time. If by space-time you mean, do you have a local Lorentz invariance? Yes, you have it. Do you mean the fact that you have a notion of adjacency? Yes, you have it. Do you have a notion of distance? Yes, you have it. So you have a geometricity already at the fundamental level, and so then if by space-time you mean something else, that is this notion of a smooth manifold, yes, this is not present there, this is something that comes later when you take the classical limit. There is something very interesting and something that I think could be challenging for a philosopher here, and this is strongly related to the kind of interpretation that you take for quantum mechanics, because I mean, in the end, so what we want to do is a quantum mechanical theory for gravity, for space-time. And so there is something very nice that is happening here. So in quantum mechanics, we talk about processes. We have states and we have processes, quantum interactions. And so in general relativity, in quantum general relativity, if you consider a finite region of space-time, this finite region of space-time is what, in the language of quantum mechanics, we call a process. And on the boundary of this process, of this space-time region, we have the states of the theory. So let me go a bit more into the details of the theory. Let me tell you a bit more about this quantum space-time. I will use this idea that we always refer to finite region of space-time rather than defining observable and infinities. In general relativity, that is the usual practice when you do particle physics. In general relativity, in order to define observables, it's much more convenient to define your theory on a locally on a finite region. So we use something that is called the boundary formalism here. And so let's take a finite region of space-time, a four-dimensional Lorentzian region, and this Lorentzian region has a boundary that defines a normal, and I can always gauge fix to this normal to be time-like. So I can define my states on the boundary of the region as space-like states. So this implies that even if my region is a Lorentzian region, the states in the boundary will be characterized by a symmetry that is SU2, namely I have a subgroup of the Lorentz group that labels my states of the geometry. So as Daniela has introduced before, so it's convenient to think about this chunk of space-time. Let's think of the states on the boundary in this gauge fixing, in which we can talk about states of space. So it's convenient to think about this little quanta of space, this chunk of space, as being some geometrical polyhedra, and the simplest one would be a tetrahedron, but the tetrahedron, so we are not constrained to talk about triangulations. In fact, the formula is much more general. You can have any kind of tetrahedra. And this tetrahedra is labeled by some variables that are the variables of that embody the gravitational field. So as I said before, the gravitational field is embodied at the classical level by the tetrads. Tetrads are reference field for each point of space-time. You can define these reference frames, reference fields, that you can orient it as you want. So there is a local invariance in space. It's a local invariance under rotation, as you choose. So that's why I have, so those are basically generators of SU2. And if I do the canonical analysis of general relativity, I discover that the conjugate variable to this, I have many of them, the conjugate variable to this, will be the Astrid-Kerr-Weber connection. But in fact, when you go to a theory of gravity that has some fundamental discreteness, you are obliged by the formalism to define this holonomy of the Astrid-Kerr-Weber connection. So your connection will be, if you define your connection as some A of X, your X is not well defined anymore because you have this dissolution of, you don't have a manifold there. So, but the notion that is still well defined is the notion of the holonomy of the connection. This is basically, for those that are familiar with particle physics, this is basically a Wilson line, a parallel transport of the connection. So these are my two variables. Those are group variables, in fact. And what is important is that even at the fundamental level, even if I'm working with these basic objects, there is already a notion of geometry that is already present there. So this is because of the Perron's spin geometry theorem, namely, so the theory is defined with a constraint, that is this one. So I have let's think of one of these quanta space-time and a lot of a number of vectors that are based there. So they have to sum up to zero. This is what the constraint is telling me. So this constraint is equivalent to give you a polyhedron. This is goes back to Minkowski, in fact. So if you have so this gives you automatically a notion of geometry, already at a very quantum level. Okay? So I started by the tetrads, generators of SU2, and with them I can construct all the geometric operators of the theory. So geometric operators means that are operators that represent things like area, volume, angles. So I wanted to describe a geometry. Those are the relevant quantities. But because I start with this compact group, so I will get a discrete spectrum for each of these operators. So you see, there is a fundamental discreteness of the theory, but the fundamental discreteness is something that appears because I have started with this with my group variables, and it's because of that then I have spectrum with the discrete that are discrete. So yeah, again, values are discrete, operators do not commute, the geometry is full quantized, and then so I can write down states of the geometry. Those states will be characterized by the graph, the adjacency relation, by the spins. So I have my generators of the of SU2, and those. So I have a representation of SU2, and those representations are always labeled by some spin. So those are the quantum number that characterize my state. So with these ingredients, I can write what are called the speed network states. But in fact, the full states of the geometry will be a superposition of geometries. So, and the best way to represent this would be with the coherent states. I will tell you more about this in a second. So, in fact, the question is, so I have these states, and I want these states to represent some geometry, but some geometry for the universe, and in particular some geometry that should be homogeneous and isotropic. So there are different strategies that I can follow in order to do this. So here there are a few of them. So in loop quantum cosmology, we have mentioned loop quantum cosmology before. In loop quantum cosmology, I start by doing a symmetry reduction, and I consider full quantum states of the theory, but in the symmetry reduced sector. So this is the first strategy. Another possible strategy is to take the states of the full theory and then gauge fix them to extract some cosmological sector. I have myself started many years ago this business trying to define cosmological states starting from the full theory in 2008, some years ago. And so what we did was, instead of starting with this with the states in the symmetry reduced theory, we introduced first some very simple states, and then we were trying to see how cosmology sit into them. And finally, so I can use coherent states picked on a homogeneous and isotropic geometry. This is also another option. And finally, there is also this other possibility to consider Bose-Einstein condensates, as Daniele told us this morning. So these are all different strategies, and the one that I highlighted are the one that I'm gonna talk about in the rest of the talk, very briefly at least. So the first thing that I wanted to tell about is loop quantum cosmology, because so this is something on which people have been working now for 18 years. So it's one of the framework that is better developed for doing quantum cosmology. There are a few things to notice. So it's this loop quantum cosmology framework is a framework in which you have full quantum states of the geometry, and you have full quantum dynamics. And so in this picture, what you see is a classical result of loop quantum cosmology, in which you have the classical trajectories leading to a singularity. And in red, you see these discrete points that are the values of the Hamiltonian constraint, giving you, so basically they are possible values of the volume. So you describe, when you do cosmology, you describe how the volume change with respect to a relational clock, a scalar field, as we have seen before. So doing this, I see that the volume take discrete values, and in particular, it always avoids the region in which the volume gets close to zero, to be zero. So the ingredients in loop quantum cosmology are are the same as the one in the full theory, in the sense that I start with the group variables, so therefore I have discrete volume, discrete spectra, and this implies a minimal area gap, a minimal volume gap, and I have a full operator. I have an operator for the Hamiltonian constraints, and using them I can study the dynamics of the universe. So for instance, here you see also a numerical evaluation of how the wave function for the universe evolves. So if you you go back in time, you see that the universe gets closer and closer to zero, but then at a certain point it starts to expand again. So as we mentioned before, I wanted to stress the fact that these equations are full quantum equations. In fact, we don't talk about differential equation anymore. So it's a discrete setting in which we have a difference equation. But then it's possible to apply our operators to some semi-classical states and recover some effective description of the theory, so that you have a very simple effective equations that you can use. Basically, you are just a modification of the Friedmann equation that we can see here in the next slide. So your Hamiltonian gets modified at an effective level in this way. You get the modification there. You see that there is a term that is the energy density rho over a critical energy density, that is an energy density at the Planck scale. So it's an energy density that controls the fact that you see the quantum effects only when you enter in the deep quantum regime. And so the question from before, do you have predictions for your for the theory in cosmology, for the CMB? Yes, there are predictions. For instance, this is an example from Abulo, Arteca, and Nelson, in which they predict for the lower modes in cosmology in excess with respect to the standard prediction. Okay. So this was very much in the same spirit as standard quantum cosmology, in the sense that the strategy is the one of going into a spherically symmetric sector of the theory and then quantize it. Historically, this was the simplest way available, because so you restrict your theory to just 1 degree of freedom, you have to deal only with the quantization of this single degrees of freedom. Time has passed, we have better technologies today. In particular, we have a quantum theory of gravity that is not complete, but is sufficiently well defined to do calculation. So this is what I have tried. So usually, you see, you follow the arrows. Usually in cosmology, to get quantum cosmology, you first symmetry reuse. So this is the standard Friedmann metric, Friedmann-Robertson-Walker metric. And then you do cosmology in this way. So what we can do now is to follow a different path to go to the quantum theory and then find a cosmological sector within the theory. The theory, the dynamics of the theory can be defined in two ways. Can be defined using a Hamiltonian, or can be defined using transition amplitudes. And in both cases, you can follow the strategy I just told you about. You try to see how a cosmological sector is present in the full theory. So what I want to talk about now are these two ideas, the cosmology and spherical cosmology. I think this is one of the most important slides of my talk, because it's related with, again, with what we mean by doing cosmology. I told you at the beginning of my talk that doing cosmology means that you are dealing with just the largest degrees of freedom. So there is an expansion in modes, and you are taking basically a truncation of this expansion. What is nice in the theory that we are working on is that all the time we can truncate the theory as well. This use of graphs allows us to do this in a very straightforward manner. So choosing a graph, choosing basically, I said, you can think of each node of the graph as being a little quanta of space-time, a little volume, and then I have the links that tells me about the relation between these quanta. So you decide how many quanta you want to describe in your system So choosing how many quanta you want to have, choosing the complexity of the graph that you use, correspond to choose how many degrees of freedom are necessary to give a meaningful description of the system you are addressing. So restricting to a given fixed graph allows us to restrict to a finite number of degrees of freedom in the theory. So this means that in particular, I can also have I can have some anisotropies, some inhomogeneities, but I truncated the theory to a finite number of degrees of freedom. And so the graph capture the large scale degrees of freedom, obtain an average on the metric, and the full theory can be regarded as an expansion for a graph that becomes larger and larger. So the simplest thing to do, so if you think on cosmology, just 1 degree of freedom means just taking one quanta or quantum of space-time, one of these tetrahedra, and studying how the volumes of these tetrahedra change. So this is one possibility. In fact, you can do even better. You can take 2 tetrahedra, glue it together, and this would be already enough to do cosmology. In fact, it would be much more than what people usually do in cosmology, because you will have enough degrees of freedom not only to describe the scale factor, but also to describe some anisotropies and some inhomogeneities of the theory. And So these are states of the full theory, and then the question is, how do I recover the standard Friedman-Robertson work dynamics? Well, one idea that we have exploited was to do a Born-Oppenheimer approximation. So if you remember, Born-Oppenheimer is a way to disentangle heavy degrees of freedom and light degrees of freedom. This was developed in particular in order to study the dynamics for the atomic nuclear, in which the nucleus was the heavy degrees of freedom, and you had your electrons floating around that were the light degrees of freedom. So in our case, we identified the heavy degrees of freedom being the one corresponding to the scale factor, and then the light degrees of freedom corresponds to the inhomogeneous and anisotropic modes. So this is something that we have done a long time ago. And and of course then you can write down an operator for the Hamiltonian constraints. Actually, you write 2 operators, one for the homogeneous sector, one for the inhomogeneous light sector. And you have some equations that, again, are equations in the full quantum theory, not in the symmetry reduced one.
Do you have a question for...
Yeah.
Can you explain a bit of that to me? I thought I heard you talking about just having one of these quanta to explain the background expansion of the universe. But you said, okay, let's do better, let's take 2.
Yeah.
And you said that is provides enough degrees of freedom to explain inhomogeneities. And
imagine, for instance, if you have just 1 tetrahedra, you can, in fact, with 1 tetrahedra, probably you have already more degrees of freedom than just the scale factor. But so a situation that you can imagine, you have these 2 tetrahedra, and you can imagine that one is smaller, one is larger. So instead of having the volume of a single volume, you can have these volumes for the 2 regions, for instance, and you can have also some anisotropies, namely you can actually Yeah, okay, because in this case, what we are gonna do, what we were doing, were to consider two tetrahedra that were regular, in order to restrict ourselves to the situation that was closer to homogeneities and isotropy. But still, yeah, the fact that I think that the picture that you should try to get in mind is this idea that you the two tetrahedra don't have to have the same size, so one can be bigger. Yes, in fact, it was we studied the number of degrees of freedom that we can account with the model, and we had Bianchi 9 that can be accommodated in the picture. So there.
So that explains why you said that can be a universe which is not isotropic, but still get heavy in
the homogeneity. Well, the thing is that there are enough degrees of freedom so that you can account for all the anisotropies of Bianchi 9, plus you still have some more degrees of freedom that you can count as representing some inhomogeneity.
So I assume it was a simple clarification question. I can see it's a clarification question, but it's not so simple.
I would be happy to discuss it.
I think what I'd like to do is to not have questions until the end. And there actually will be two times you can ask questions. At the end of this talk, and then after both talks at the panel discussion. So I now would just like to have it, but you better just let.
Yeah, okay. So, but thank you for the question, and I look forward to discuss it more later. I wanted to talk about the last thing, that is, the one to which I devoted most of the work, that was to use coherent states to describe a homogeneous and isotropic geometry. And again, so I said at the beginning, the idea is that you have this quantum state of the geometry, but the actual geometry is realized by a superposition of those states, as usual in the quantum theory. And in particular, you can choose coherent states that can be picked on a specific geometry. And this geometry, you can choose it to be the homogeneous and isotropic one. So the coherent states are particularly nice because so we can associate to them a geometrical interpretation. So for instance, in the case of this, maybe it's not worth it to go into the details of it, but again, so the label of these coherent states are associated with the geometrical quantities like these normals to the faces of these fundamental tetrahedra or polyhedra, and the label of the coherent states is also associated, the Z is associated with the quantities representing the gravitational field, namely the curvature and the area living on the faces of those tetrahedra. So altogether, this allows to describe some concrete geometry. And again, I can decide to pick them on a homogeneous and isotropic geometry to do cosmology. So if then I have these coherent states that live on my boundary, those are homogeneous and homogeneous and isotropic states living on the boundary, I can associate a path integral, a sum over all possible four-dimensional geometries that are compatible with this spatial geometry on the boundary. And this is what is nothing but what is known as a Hartle-Hawking wave function of the universe. So the Hartle-Hawking wave function of the universe tells me for a given geometry of space, what is the probability for this geometry to exist? And in fact, I can take two of these geometries, let's say an initial and the final geometry, I can glue them together, and what I get is our transition amplitudes, the probability to go from one geometry to the other. So if I have a quantum geometry of the universe and another quantum geometry of the universe, I can associate the probability for this process to happen. So I can associate the probability, in fact, for a given four-dimensional Lorentz region of space-time. So in loop quantum gravity, we have well-defined transition amplitudes, again with a number of nice properties. This is an expansion in vertices that is fully Lorentz covariant, is UV and infrared finite. And as I said, there are theorems, there are many works showing you how this transition amplitude gives you back in the classical limit general relativity. So a work that I have done myself was exactly to see how this transition amplitude in the cosmological constant, in the cosmological context, gives back cosmology, in the sense that I can recover Minkowski spacetime, namely I can recover the Sitter spacetime, Bianchi 1 spacetime. So for instance, in this I can do this analytically, and we have also studied this numerically. So what you see in these two pictures, this is for Minkowski, this is for the Sitter. So what these two pictures are representing is where my transition amplitude is peaked. This is what I was saying before during the discussion, namely that in the classical limit, our transition amplitude selects, is peaked on the classical trajectory. The trajectory is corresponding to the Friedman equation of motion of cosmology. And all the other configurations of the geometry not corresponding to these classical trajectories are suppressed by the dynamics itself. So again, this shows you how classical spacetime emerges in this particular sense from the quantum theory to the classical one. I would like to spend 5 more minutes if I can.
Yeah. How much time do you want to leave for questions?
Well, let me take 5 more minutes, okay. Because I wanted to arrive to this. I have just a couple of slides more, and I think they would be important.
Yeah, go for it.
Yeah, okay. So how is the dynamics defined? Let me sketch very briefly something from the classical theory, from general relativity. In general relativity, again, I wanted to use a formulation of general relativity based on the metric, not using the metric, but using the tetrads. So my variables are the tetrads and the Cartan connection that is there. So in these variables, the action of general relativity becomes this one, with where I have this the B field that is a two-form, and also F that is a two-form that represents the curvature, and the B field has this form written in terms of the tetrads, and so the theory constrain the B field to have this particular form. So this is what this gives on a particular. If I go back to the gauge I was using before, the one in which the states on the boundary are indeed space-like, then the simplicity constraint, the constraint that project my theory, my BF, the theory in the second line there, my BF theory into general relativity, is this one. So what this relation is telling me is that the theory is based on the Lorentz group. So I have in the gauge in which the tetrads are diagonal, then what I get is that there is a duality between the electric part of the gravitational field and the magnetic part of the gravitational field. Namely, I have a relation between the rotation and the boost. So the boost and the rotation should be proportional to one another. And this is a fact that is true at the level of the classical theory. So here I'm not talking about quantum gravity. I'm just telling you something that is true at the classical level. But the point is that once I have this relation, then I will put a hat. So K is a generator of the boost. L is a generator of the rotation. It's the same L that you have seen before. I put a hat on them, and I get my the dynamics of my quantum theory. And what is interesting is the fact that because of this relation, then I can define a Lorentzian area that is defined in this way, but because of the relation that there is here, this is also equal to this Euclidean area. So then I told you before that this Euclidean area is quantized. We have seen that we have seen that the operator giving the area in the theory is has a discrete spectrum. So what I obtain here is the fact that this discrete spectrum here in the quantum theory, but there is also a discrete spectrum here in the quantum theory. So the fact that there is this Lorentzian area that is quantized imply the fact that what is this Lorentzian area? Lorentzian area is an area in which one of the direction is a time-like direction. So you can think that is the area that is spanned in this graph by some observer that is accelerating with a constant acceleration. So because of the fact that this area should be quantized, the acceleration of this hypothetical observer should have a maximum, should be bounded. So there is a maximal acceleration, and a maximal acceleration is equivalent to say that there is no singularities in the curvature. So this is a very simple manner in which you can derive the fact that the theory, as it is defined, cannot develop curvature singularities. So there is no Big Bang, there is no singularity in the center of the black hole. And also there is something else that I wanted to point to your attention, that is the following thing, that the relation between the boost and the rotation, because the generators of the rotation were the one that were giving me the area, and the boost are in fact the one that I can associate with a Hamiltonian for this accelerated observer, so I can associate an energy to this. So I have directly a relation between energy and area. So given this relation, so giving you the dynamics of the theory in, using the simplicity constraint is equivalent to telling you that there is this proportionality between energy and area. But this is exactly the relation that is used all the time when we do black hole entropy and so on. So given this relation and introducing a Uru temperature, with these two ingredients together, I get immediately the usual standard Hawking relation between the black hole entropy and the area. So here you see that, so I can interpret this entropy as an entanglement entropy that is not something that appears just for black hole, it's something that is more general and inform the whole structure, the whole architecture of space-time, if you want. So the fact that I can interpret this as an entanglement entropy is related to the fact that the theory is ultraviolet finite, so, and is also related to the fact that Eugenio Bianchi some years ago shown that this entanglement entropy doesn't depend on the number of species, on the number of different matter fields that are present. So this way to obtain the entropy, this way to talk about the entropy as directly from the structure of space-time should ring you a bell about the fact that you don't need to talk about underlying thermodynamical degrees of freedom in order to build up your theory. So all these ideas of emergent gravity, namely having some thermodynamical degrees of freedom and then from them obtaining back the equations of general relativity, well, I think the situation is quite the opposite, that all the time that people try to do those things, in fact, they are hiding under the carpet the fact that they are using the simplicity constraint, namely this relation between energy and area. Okay, so this concludes my presentation. And here there is a short summary, but I think we will have more time to discuss this, all these things also in the discussion later. Thank you for your attention.
Questions?
So I have a couple of questions. said you can gauge fix to fix the normal as time lag? I didn't understand that.
Well, it's simply the fact that so you have this four-dimensional space-time region. Having a finite region implies the presence of some bound. And on some bound, the presence of these three-dimensional boundaries.
So the three-dimensional boundary in principle could be?
It could be everything.
Any signature with respect to the outside?
Yes. Yes, in principle the boundary can be any projection of the of the variables, the four-dimensional variables that lives in the four-dimensional Lorentz space-time in this three-dimensional surface, on this three-dimensional surface. And then, because there is this boundary, this surface, there is some normal associated to this, and again, this normal can be whatever in principle.
But it's supposed to match some signature from the outside.
By signature you mean...
Signature mean that it's contraction, its norm should be positive or negative to match with what's coming from the outside.
Well, the... From there, so, okay, so here, I see what you mean. The idea is that, so I see what you're saying. I'm cutting my space-time,
yeah.
And no, I don't think you have, so in principle, the idea is that I can always do a transformation, isn't it? I can do a transformation so that the space-time itself is not fixed because in the so that the direction, what is a null direction here is not fixed. It depends on the way in which you choose the coordinates to describe your space-time.
I don't understand. I mean, a null direction is important.
Hmm?
It's no. It's a statement about the geometry direction being no. So,
sorry, are you repeating the question?
So she was saying that you have this boundary and you can use a gauge transformation to set the normal to the boundary of this region on space-time, which are the transition amplitudes, to be always time-like.
I say that a gauge fix it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I didn't understand, but then my question was, but in principle, your surface doesn't have to be time-like itself, so that was my question. Or
yeah.
Do you only take the surface to a red, sorry, space-like? So do you take two things that are supposed to be Cauchy surfaces, or partial Cauchy surfaces, so just space-like the two, and then, sure, you can have a normal that is time-like. But that's not my impression. My impression is that what she said was you can take any such region in space-time, and you can always gauge fix the normal to these,
yes.
to these surfaces to be time. And then I'm confused because then it should match, the normal should match what is coming from the classical part of the space-time.
Okay, we're gonna be able to come back to this and you guys can all think about it. And we got another question here.
I mean, you do make it one of your, four major claims, so I'm going to take you up on it. So, cosmology, the study of the universe in its larger scale. Would you agree that it's the study of the universe as a closed system?
Is it?
Would you agree that it is the study of the universe as a closed system?
I think there is no... Oh. Okay, no, I think that if you think of the universe as a closed system, then you're doing the theory of everything.
Why?
Maybe I am misinterpreting your question. Because what I was saying before was the fact that, so it's closed in the sense that I consider the universe to be something finite. Whether it is finite or not, in every case I have access to some finite region when I do cosmology.
I mean, just a point. Normally when one speaks about a closed system, it isn't specifically that it's finite. That's not the point. The point is it doesn't interact with anything else.
But isn't, Okay, yes, I assume, well, I call the universe the region of space-time that I don't see interacting with anything else.
Okay, so
yeah.
it
exhausts all the interactions that I see.
Right, so it's not interacting with anything else?
Yes,
okay.
By definition, I would say.
Okay, good. I would agree that it sort of more or less means that. Now, fine, to schematize this thing, the actual universe, schematize it, simplify it, but can we also agree that that is all that is going on with this first statement? If we agree that the universe is a closed system, so, and you didn't actually write it up there,
mm-hmm.
It was in your earlier slides.
Yeah.
You place somehow great emphasis that cosmology is only, you know, it's sort of not some big thing, it's some big project, it's some little project.
Yes.
We're only looking at a certain degree of freedom.
Yes.
But are we agreed that, okay, if we're going to only look at certain degrees of freedom, that's in the interest of simplification. If it is a closed system, then we can be in agreement with one another. Are you happy with that? So it's a closed system and we're simplifying that closed system. Okay,
I'm
good,
very
good.
Fine with it.
Good.
Yes.
Okay,
I think that for somebody doing quantum gravity again, or somebody doing general relativity, doing cosmology. So you know, when you give a cosmology to students as a toy model to learn about the theory. So yes, definitely, my
right.
mind of doing cosmology is doing
good.
Something simpler.
Good. Good. But then my question is, why did you bother to make a big fuss about it?
Because some friends of yours keep on talking about how difficult it is to do cosmology because we have to describe all the degrees of freedom that are present in the universe, or maybe I am misunderstanding.
Well, I don't know
the problem.
I don't know that they're friends of mine, but anyway.
Sorry.
I would ask you to be more open about what I think is going on here.
So, but I understand. So, let me allow me to understand better. What is the? Do you have any disagreement?
I don't disagree.
I'd
be happy to conclude that we don't have a disagreement, but I suspect that this is a very superficial agreement.
Okay, but where is the deep disagreement then?
Well, I'd like to know why you are at pains to stress this somehow. I mean, of course, we're not doing grand unification. Sure, we're trying to simplify, we're just looking at certain degrees of freedom, fine, but that sort of goes without saying. You know, normally, if we're talking about quantum mechanics, for example, I'm not particularly bothered about going into the ins and outs of biological systems. It goes without saying. You know, one sort of simplifies. So, fine. If that's all that's going on, then I absolutely have no problem. But I suspect that there's something else that's going on.
Okay, what would be this something else?
I'm not going to
defend the people who are saying that there is something else going on. So if you think that there is something else going on, please tell me so and we can discuss
well,
it.
Right. So you talked about the observer.
Yes.
What is that's going on?
Okay, so as I said in my talk, I think, so we have an expansion in modes. You can think that the first mode in this expansion is the one that we associate with the large structure of the universe, the size of the universe, for instance. This is what we describe in cosmology. And we observers are very little degrees of freedom that are in the end of this expansion, let's say. So we are not part of the degrees of freedom that we are describing.
And why mention observers at all?
Can I have a footnote?
Because, okay, I mention observers for the following reason, because I think that any description in physics is always about a system described with respect to a given observer. It's always the case. It's always a relation. So I needed to declare with the observer who is...
Can I just have a... I mean, as a matter of fact, there are people, George Ellis, for example, who say cosmology has this peculiar problem that other other sciences don't have, in that it's supposed to be a description of everything, including the observer as part of it.
So there are people saying.
And if you think that the way to do quantum mechanics is to describe systems with respect to an observer, that would pose a problem for cosmology. Now, I think everyone in this room has agreed that actually, no, cosmologists study big degrees of freedom out there. The telescope itself is not part of the subject. It's a tool used in cosmology, but not part of the subject matter of cosmology.
Thank you, Wade.
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh, well, then I'm not a person in this room who agrees with that.
Oh, okay. Everyone except Simon.
Okay, except Simon. But I'm very surprised to find myself isolated. I would say that. I mean, sure, cosmology is not particularly concerned with the properties of optical experiments, but there's no problem with bringing them in if we need to.
I would agree if we needed to, but
indeed. So if an issue of the observer arises, if somehow there's a perspectival relationship, then what is the observer in relation to the universe? How is it in relation to the universe? Which is why I pose the question in terms of, would you agree that cosmology is the study of a closed system?
Yeah, but even if...
So
okay.
There's no interaction between the observer and the universe.
Okay, but no, I think, okay, in this case, I disagree, in the sense that, okay, no, it's not...
I thought not.
Okay, now I see your... this is my first fault, so I'm not...
So you take that back?
Yeah, I take that back, and I think that there is no way... So by definition, if what you mean by closed system is something that doesn't interact with anything, you don't have access to it, we don't do physics in this way.
No, we're inside it.
Yeah?
We're inside it.
We are inside it, but...
that's thereby a closed system.
Yes, but all the time, okay. See, yeah, but then you have to perform a partition of your system. So any kind of dynamics, any kind of physics, basically, you may be able to do, is always... under the first step of making a partition of the system into observer and observed.
It happens nowhere else in physics.
It happens all the time in physics. There is not a single theory in all contemporary physics in which you don't do this. Give me an example.
I only know relational theories. I think you should pursue it. So take gravity.
Yes.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
So take simple Newtonian gravity.
Yes.
Fine. So take means of observation and Newtonian gravity.
Mm-hmm.
Add in a little bit of optics. No problem. So we describe a closed system, maybe just a finite system. Let's take a solar system. We include a bit of electromagnetic theory, and we include a bit of optics. And we have a telescope that we also model within the system. What's the problem?
Earlier we were talking about the need to introduce a market field, clock field. Now, I would claim that we are using a closed system, and that at the classical level, the observer is something related to the clock field. So we measure particular geometrical properties as a function of the clock. Now, I'm addressing your question at a purely classical level, classical physics level.
But are you saying that at that level there is no description which contains within it the instrumentation used to record data?
That would all be, it would be extra stuff that you add to the clock field.
It would be what?
Extra things that you add to the clock field. You can add.
Sure.
More matter, but the key thing is that you have to have this clock field around.
But that clock is also modeled within the system.
The clock field is modeled within the system. It's part of the graph.
Yeah.
Which is in agreement with my problem.
I'm going to start.
But it's at the classical physics level. At the quantum level, I could not answer your question.
Absolutely. No. It's not that I'm ignorant. We all know that there's a problem with measurement, and the worry is that it's getting brushed under the carpet.
The problem, okay, yes, here I am taking a very peculiar position with respect to the problem of measurement,
sure.
Saying that measurements are relational, interactions are relational, and so on. So yeah, so this discussion should be informed with the peculiar interpretation of quantum mechanics that each of us is adopting, of course.
You replace the observer with the microwave background, and then we measure the expansion rate of space as a function of the temperature of the microwave background. So this is the closed classroom system.
Yes, I don't think we're in disagreement. But I think Francesca and I are, but never mind.
I don't think you agree with Robert.
It's clear there's much more to be discussed. But I think we should have time to take a break now. And so let us thank our speaker. And,